Okay, so let me begin. Are there questions?
Oh, yes, sir.
Yes, go ahead, please.
I think Harshit also has one. He can go first.
Okay, yeah, go ahead.
I was asking, like, what are the features of like this sigma that we defined last time? I mean, it we can solve it to solve for the mass of particles that exist in the theory.
Yes.
I mean, sigma could also contain some poles, right?
Sigma typically doesn't contain poles. They're not, at least not in perturbation theory.
Okay.
Yeah, so sigma typically will not contain poles because sigma is the inverse propagator, right? That if sigma contains poles, that will mean that the propagator has a zero.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. So that doesn't have a particular significance. It's the poles of the propagator which are significant. And the residue. Okay. Maybe this is something I should have said, that once sigma also tells us how to calculate the residue. You remember that in the earlier we had arrived at this formula, right? This was the general formula for G tilde near the pole. This is a single particle contribution. So using this sigma, we can also calculate this Z, and that will be important in what we are going to do today and next time, so tomorrow.
So those Z are the two things. Overlap of, Z is just telling whether phi produces one single particle state or not.
No, that's not true. Z is giving the normalization of phi. See, even if phi produces one single particle state,
right, yeah,
Z can be not equal to one. It's just a normalization of phi. It's just saying that the phi is correct, not the correctly normalized state that produces 1 over p square plus mp square. Okay. Z, let me remind you where the Z came from. Yeah, see, Z was this quantity. Right, so it basically gives normalization of phi with respect to single particle states. So if there are two particles, for example, right, then it is true that this may get contribution from both particles. So it will be like Z1 plus Z2. But then you can consider other composite operators which will have a different combination, and that way you can distinguish between having two particles as opposed to having one particle. But Z can be not equal to one, even if there is only one particle in the problem.
Okay, yeah. And one more thing, does sigma have any more information than like the mass of particles? Consider the anharmonic oscillator. In that case, I would assume that after solving this equation for, as we are solving for mass of particles here, we would get the energy eigenstates and of these anharmonic oscillators, because it is here the mass is the energy mode for energy part of zero dimension field theory.
Yes,
there's only one component in the momentum, so that is energy there.
Yeah.
So sigma would give us the energy eigenstates of an anharmonic oscillator. Would it also give anything more than that? I mean, last time you were saying it could have complex solutions also. So
complex solutions, typically what are they are called resonances. If sigma has complex solutions which are not very far from the real axis, they describe unstable particles in this case. So this equation, for example, could have complex solution.
Yeah.
And those will correspond to unstable particles in the theory. So any pole. So, okay, let me put it this way, that sigma, the two-point Green's function can be changed by redefinition of fields. Okay. Suppose you started with phi to the fourth theory and you define phi as chi plus chi square. And you didn't know whether the phi is the elementary field or chi is the elementary field. So if you try to start doing calculation with chi, you will in general get a different sigma and a different two-point function. But the location of the pole is not going to change. So the location of the pole is something that is independent of any redefinition of fields that you can make. So in that sense, MP is more fundamental than the pole of sigma itself, because the sigma itself depends on which particular two-point function you are considering. In fact, as we discussed, that instead of having the two-point function of phi's, you could have calculated two-point function of other operators, say phi cube. Okay, phi cube two-point function. That obviously will have a different Feynman expand diagram expansion, and it will have a different structure here. But that will have pole exactly in the same place, MP. So in that sense, the location of the poles of the Green's function are more robust than the full information about the Green's function.
Okay. And sigma can also have branch cuts, as you said last.
Yeah, in general, sigma can also have branch cuts.
Yeah, okay.
Also?
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, I was saying that we are considering, like, we are depending totally upon the Lagrangian that we have, right? In the sense that like, standard model has a given Lagrangian that we have guessed, like as we do with Lagrangians, that we have to guess based on experiments and all. Yeah. But how can we be like, the only things that we have in that help us in guessing is that something like Lorentz invariance or Poincaré invariance. And we can add any number of terms as long as they are Lorentz invariant, and there are infinitely many finite dimensional representations of the Lorentz algebra. So why are we so sure about our Lagrangian, like in standard model, let's say?
No, we are not so sure. But the point is, if you add more fields,
yeah,
typically you will get more particles.
Yeah.
Okay, which we haven't observed. Now you can always add particles which are heavier than what we have probed in experiments, okay. And that you can never rule out. Okay. So we can only say that the standard model is the correct Lagrangian up to a certain energy scale. Okay, because we haven't seen any other particle, so you cannot simply keep adding more fields, because more fields will mean more particles. Okay. You can say, why not take the same number of fields and add more terms? Okay. There, what happens is that if you add more terms, the theory becomes non-normalizable. Okay, so you don't know how to make sense of this. So if we postulate that we only focus on renormalizable theories, then, and if you have a given number of fields, then there is only a certain number of terms you can add. And standard model basically adds everything that is consistent with symmetries and renormalizability. Okay, and the number of fields you fix.
So higher dimensional representations are like inherently non-renormalizable.
Yeah, so basically once you go beyond spin one, they become non-normalizable. Okay, in four dimensions. Like gravity, as I discussed, is non-normalizable. If you go to higher spin, they'll also become non-normalizable. In fact, I mean, there is a general result that you cannot have an interacting theory of higher spin fields without violating some consistency condition.
Okay. And also, you were also saying that we can, as a thumb rule, check for renormalizability by checking the dimension of lambda. If it has inverse mass dimension, then it is usually not renormalizable.
Yes.
So, is this only when we have like perturbations like phi to the power 4? If I were to add something like pi square, or well, pi square is already there, but pi 4.
Oh, this is true in general. Not just for phi to the 4.
Yeah, not on the field, not on the interaction field, but simply on the parameter.
On the parameter, yes. The okay. Parameter in which you are doing the perturbation, right? So the basic idea is that the more parts of the parameter you have, right? Suppose you are calculating some given quantity, right? So if you have more parts of the parameter, the total dimension, of course, has to be fixed, right? Because you are calculating a given quantity which has a fixed dimension. So if you get more and more mass dimension in the denominator, right, then something must compensate for it, right? And yeah. What compensates for it are the loop momentum. Okay, momentum parts. And momentum parts means loop momentum typically. Right? So more parts of loop momentum means that the integral will be more divergent for large loop momentum. Right? Yeah. This argument one can make more precise, right? But this is the general idea.
Okay. Yeah. Okay.
So the basic point is that once you fix the number of fields, right, you don't have to go to higher spin, right? I mean, you can add more and more scalars, for example, in the standard model, right? Nobody can prevent you from doing that. You can build a perfectly normalizable theory, except that more and more scalars means that there should be more and more scalar particles that you should observe, right? Unless their masses are very high. And that, as I said, you can never rule out.
All right.
Any other question?
Yes,
go ahead, please.
Sir, in lecture 23, as we have defined, the FQ is a Fourier transform of G plus. Sir, I just want to know that. FQ.
Yeah, the page.
Yeah, this one, sir. This one.
Okay.
Yeah, this one. Sir, we have defined the FQ is a Fourier transform of G plus. Sir, I just want to know the two conditions like we have defined for FQ is must be Lorentz invariant, also vanish for Q square greater than zero or Q zero less than zero. FQ must be vanishes. So, sir, I just want to know that these two conditions are predefined or that must be true for Fourier transform of G plus.
No, this you can prove. That this is true for Fourier transform of G plus, right? And one proof, for example, the second result, right? That FQ is zero for Q zero, Q zero less than zero, right? That just follows from the definition of FQ. Okay, that if you look at this FQ, in order for this FQ to not be zero, right, there must be some PN which is equal to Q, right? Because there is a delta function sitting here. So there should be some PN for which PN zero should be equal to Q zero. Now, if Q zero is negative, that will require that there must be some state n for which the energy is negative. And that we have already excluded because a vacuum has zero energy. Right? That's what we have assumed. So all states should have positive energy.
Okay, sir.
That's the proof that FQ must vanish for Q0 less than zero. The other two also we have proved somewhere. Let me say where. Yeah, so here I have proved FQ lambda Q equal to FQ, right? That we had already proven some property of G plus. Based on this, and using that, we proved here that f of lambda q is equal to fq. So it's not that we assume this, right? We can actually prove this based on whatever you have done earlier.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Any other question? Okay, so let me then begin. Okay, so what we have seen so far is how to extract the masses of physical particles from the analysis of the two-point Hertz function. I think something is wrong here. There is a red mark. I cannot figure out where it came from. Okay, I think I'm going to have to exit and then start again. It seems to be on.
You can stop sharing for a second and then share again.
Okay, let me. Yeah, so this. Okay. Okay, so what we have seen so far is how to extract the masses of physical particles from the analysis of the two-point Green's function. Let me just do also one more thing. So what we are going to try to do now is how to calculate scattering amplitudes from the analysis of endpoint Green's function. So what do you mean by scattering amplitude? Okay, so let me try to explain physically. So the goal is that we want to calculate the probability of observing a certain outcome, like m particles going out in along some specific directions when you collide n particles with each other. So imagine that you do an experiment, and this is a typical experiment that we do. That you take two particles and throw them at each other. In general, you can imagine we collide n particles and throw them at each other, and then we observe the outcome. Now, of course, in quantum mechanics, if you repeat the experiment, you will not get the same outcome. But if you repeat it many times, then you can assign probabilities for various outcomes. And the possible outcomes are certain number of particles going out in certain directions. Okay, so that's what you want to calculate. Okay, that is what is captured by scattering amplitudes. So I'll define more specifically what exactly one means by scattering amplitudes. But physically, this is the question you are going to ask. But to do that, you have to first go back to free field theory and develop some formalism there. So let me remind you that in free field theory, we had this expression for the scalar field, which is given here. Okay, so I had written the scalar field in terms of its Fourier transform, and we had also written the expression for the Fourier transform phi tilde in terms of A and A dagger, and this is the expression. Okay, if you have forgotten, you can just go back to your notes. Okay, for expressions for phi in terms of phi tilde, and then phi tilde in terms of A and A dagger. So at time t, this is the expression, but I'll be working at time t equal to zero, okay, because we'll be building up the Schrödinger Heisenberg picture states. So at t equal to zero, let's define the state f as this linear combination. So you take the operator phi 0 r acting on 0, multiply it by some function f of r. Okay. At present, f of r is any function, which I'll specify later, and then integrate over r. This is what I'll call the state f. So given a function, we can construct given a function of three spatial space coordinates, we can construct a state f this way. And then using this fact that phi 0 r is given by this combination acting on the this combination, and the fact that A of course annihilates the vacuum, so only this term contributes, okay, A t minus P dagger, I can rewrite this part of the expression phi 0 r on vacuum in this fashion. And what I have done here is that I have changed the integration variable P to minus P, so this e to the I P dot r has become e to the minus I P dot r, and this A minus P dagger has become AP dagger. And now I'm not writing the time argument anymore, because A zero P is AP. That's the way, that's the notation we had introduced earlier. So FR is some arbitrary function, okay, at this stage. So is this clear what you have done here? Okay. So now we are going to define a state, which in fact I had introduced even earlier, single particle state, which is AP dagger on vacuum, but now we are going to multiply it by square root of 2AP. And this follows from the fact that we have been using this natural Lorentz invariant normalization, in which PP prime inner product is 2AP times delta QP minus P prime. So in order to ensure that, I have just included this normalization factor of square root of 2AP. In the definition of the state P. And we'll also introduce this function f tilde, which is a Fourier transform of f of r, which is given here. Okay, so this is just a Fourier transform of f of r. Then the same state f, which we had here, I can also rewrite in terms of its Fourier transform. So basically, integral dq bar f of r e to the minus ip dot r over 2 pi to the 3 by 2. I can call f tilde of p, okay, this r integral. So I'm doing the r integral first, calling it f tilde of p, and that's what we have here. So we have the 1 over square root of 2ep, ap dagger, that's as before, except that this has become f tilde of p. And this I can now rewrite as dqp over 2ep f tilde p times p. This square root of 2ep, okay, and there is a square root of tp in the numerator of the definition of p. Okay, so that makes it 2ep. And now let me specify what we'll choose for f, okay, or equivalently f tilde. So we'll choose f tilde to be a Gaussian, which is centered around some momentum k. And sigma or root sigma is the width of the Gaussian. So we'll take f tilde of p in this form. This precise form is not really important. It's some function that should be peaked around some particular momentum k. And I have normalized it so that in the standard way. Okay, but again, the precise choice is not important. Okay, instead of using a Gaussian, you could have used some other form, as long as it's a nicely peaked function. Now, if you take the Fourier transform of this, okay, we'll get f of r, and that's given here. So this is a Gaussian in the space coordinates. And of course, as is expected, the widths are opposite of each other. So in the momentum space, the width is root sigma. In the position space, the width is one over root sigma. And that's, of course, the standard uncertainty principle, okay, that you cannot specify the momentum and position both together. And we'll imagine that the sigma is very small. Okay, I'll make it more specific later. So that this f tilde of p is almost like a delta function around k. Okay, but we'll not take it to be exactly a delta function. We'll take it to have a width which is very small. Okay, are there questions? So this will be the definition of the state f. Okay, it's still a single particle state that you are defining because it's a superposition of single particle state, except that it's not a momentum eigenstate anymore, okay, because you have averaged over different momentum, okay, around some value k. Okay, so here this is a collection of all the results that we had in the last slide. Okay, this is the definition of p, this is the definition of the state f, both in the coordinate representation and in the momentum representation. This is a Fourier transform, and these are the specific forms of f and f tilde. So before we go on, let's try to interpret this in the language of quantum mechanics. These are, of course, these are just single particle states, right? So one should be able to also describe them in as quantum mechanics, in terms of quantum mechanics. And so interpretation in quantum mechanics is that because we are interpreting this p as the momentum eigenstate of a single particle of eigenvalue p, f tilde of p should be thought of as a momentum space wave function of the particle. Okay, because you are taking the linear combination of this. So this, in this form, it's clear that this is giving a superposition of momentum eigenstates. So if this is the case, then f of r is just a Fourier transform of f tilde of p. So this should be interpreted as a position space wave function. So, and that's again not unexpected, okay, because if you look at the definition of the state f, right, it definition of the state f here, that this is, if this is peaked around r equal to 0, that means the state is created by phi at 0. Okay, and that's what you expect. The intuition says that if you want to create a particle at a position r, okay, you should use something like phi 0 r. Okay, this is at time t equal to 0, but at r equal to 0. And that is what is more made precise here, okay, that f of r, okay, being the Fourier transform of the momentum space wave function, should be interpreted as a position space wave function. So this is something I think I've already said. So what this is showing is that the particle states whose position wave functions are localized on r equal to 0, okay, like this one, okay, with f of r is position space localized, wave function is localized on r equal to 0 because the peak is at r equal to 0. So from this it shows that it's weighted by phi around r equal to 0, right? Because f of r reaches its maximum around r equal to 0, and that's what multiplies phi. So the state is created by action of phi 0 r around r equal to 0. So are there any questions?
So please repeat this line.
This line, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, so what I'm saying is that, this argument is showing that f of r should be interpreted as a position space wave function. Okay. Now look at the structure of f of r. So f of r is peaked around r equal to 0. Okay. So the particular state that we're considering, okay, should be describing a particle whose wave function is peaked around r equal to 0. Okay. All of this is happening at t equal to 0. Okay. So it should be described by a particle whose wave function is peaked around r equal to 0. Okay. On the other hand, from the definition of f, we see that with f of r being given by this Gaussian, this weightage factor tells us that f is created by phi around r equal to 0. So what we learn from here is that if we want to create a particle around the point r equal to 0, right, whose wave function is localized around r equal to 0, the operator that creates such a particle is a linear combination of the phis, which are all concentrated around r equal to 0. So instead of saying strictly that phi 0, 0 creates the particle at r equal to 0, we are saying if you want to create a particle whose wave function is localized around r equal to 0, in the form of this Gaussian, then you should use phis with weightage which are again localized around r equal to 0. Is this point clear?
Yes, sir.
Sir?
Yes.
So in the definition of ket f?
Yes.
The weightage, you are saying that the phi r is not exactly at r is equals to 0, it is centered around r is equals to 0.
Yeah, and the wave function of the particle is also centered around r equal to 0.
Yeah, so in the definition of ket f, it is this information is contained in f of r.
Yes, exactly.
Okay.
Yeah. So we are trying to avoid delta functions. Okay, we are using, so f is sometimes called the smearing function. Okay, we are using a function that is that smears the wave function both in the position space as well as in the momentum space. Okay. And this is going to be important for later use. Any other question? Okay, so this of course is not dependent on r equal to 0 itself. By translational invariance of the theory, it also follows that if you want to create a state around say r equal to r naught, then you should use phis around r equal to r naught. So this I have already said, we will choose this width root sigma. Okay, this is a width in the momentum space. Okay. We'll choose this to be small compact to mod k. So the width of the distribution in the momentum space is small compared to the central value of the momentum. And this is again going to be important. Okay. So the central value of the momentum should be much larger than the width. In fact, eventually, okay, we'll consider the limit where the width goes to zero. Okay, that the moment that these states are sharply peaked. Okay. But nevertheless, we are not setting it equal to zero at this stage, because you have to set it equal to zero. Okay, we have to take this limit, okay, carefully, that we have to take the limit. There will be multiple limits, okay, and it should be important as to which order you use to take the limits. Okay, and we'll describe it in more detail as we go along, or it will become clear automatically as we go along why you have to do this. Okay, are there questions? So if we take this approach that the width is small compared to the actual magnitude, then for most of the integrals, we can in fact take this EP factor out of the integral. Okay, we can just set EP equal to EK in the sigma goes to zero limit, for example. We can set EP equal to EK and take it out of the integral. Now we cannot always do that, and we'll see sometimes you have to be careful. But in many cases, we particularly factors of EP which are like this, right, which are not multiplied by something else which may be large, we can take them out of the integral. So you can write this as 1 over square root of 2, 1 over 2 ek times integral d cube kf tilde pp. Okay, so now, so far we have been using Heisenberg picture, and we'll continue to use Heisenberg picture. Okay, so for all calculations, we'll be using Heisenberg picture. Nevertheless, it is useful to get physical insight about the states. It's useful to ask how the state looks in the Schrodinger picture. That what would have happened if you take the state, a particular state, and evolve it according to Schrodinger picture. So let's ask that question about this state f that you have introduced, right? That if we take this state f and evolve according to the Schrodinger picture, how would it look? Okay. Now, before we answer this question in the present context, let's remind ourselves that in non-relativistic quantum mechanics, we know how it should evolve, right? If you start with the Gaussian wave function, we know that in position space, the peak of the Gaussian wave function will move according to classical equations of motion. But at the same time, the width will increase. And the width, if you remember your results in quantum mechanics, the width of the wave function increases with time as square root of t, okay, or square root of mod t. And we'll see that the same result holds also in this relativistic case, except that the peak will move along the trajectory of a relativistic particle. Okay, instead of along a non-relativistic particle. Are there questions up to this point? Okay, so let's then start doing the calculations. So we'll denote by Tf, okay, the state f that we had introduced, okay, that was at time t equal to 0 because we are using Heisenberg picture. Okay, but let's ask what would have happened if we had used Schrodinger picture and evolved this state. Okay, so and that's what we will call the state Tf. So then it will evolve, of course, according to the Schrodinger equation. Okay, I del del T of Tf should be H times Tf. Okay. And with the boundary condition that 0f should be equal to the state f. Now to solve this, okay, I mean, in fact, the solution is more or less obvious what it should be, because after all, we have seen that the single particle states are exactly energy eigenstates in the free theory. So if we take the state f and evolve it, okay, it has a linear combination of single particle state, so it should remain a linear combination of single particle state. So let's take an arbitrary linear combination of single particle states and call that corresponding coefficient as f tilde tp. Okay, so this is the trial solution we'll use. And then substitute in this equation of motion, in the Schrodinger equation. And then we just substitute this in the Schrodinger equation. On the left hand side, you get I del del T of F tilde. On the right hand side, H acting on this gives you EP, right? Because P is an eigenstate of H with an eigenvalue EP, which is square root of P square plus M square. So using this, we can convert this into this simple differential equation for F tilde with the boundary condition that F tilde is 0, P is equal to F tilde of P. And that gives a solution that f tilde tp is given by this. So we can now then replace f tilde of p by f tilde of tp in all the earlier formula, okay, to see what's how it looks in various representations, right? Position space representation or momentum space representation. So for example, the tf in the position space representation will be given by this. Okay, so this is basically what we are doing, is that we are using this formula, except that f of r will be now replaced by f of tr, okay, which is the Fourier transform of f tilde of tp. Okay. And f tilde of tp just uses an extra multiplicative factor of e to the minus iept. Okay. So you multiply this by e to the minus iept and Fourier transform, and that's what we're calling f of tr. Okay, so this is then tf. So f of tr is given by this, okay, the Fourier transform of f tilde p times e to the minus iept. Okay, are there questions? Is this clear to everybody so far? Okay, so let me proceed. Okay, so here, yeah, I have collected all the results. Okay, TF is given by this. FTR is the Fourier transform of F tilde P, e to the minus IP times F tilde P. And in this line, I have just replaced F tilde P by the choice that we had made earlier, the Gaussian peaked around K. So now you have to evaluate this integral, right, to find FTR. Now, unfortunately, in this case, the integral cannot be evaluated exactly. Okay, in the non-relativistic case, where EP was P squared by 2m, you could do the P integral by standard Gaussian integration. Here, you cannot evaluate it exactly. Nevertheless, because you have taken sigma to be small, it's clear that from this exponential, that when P minus K is much larger than root sigma, okay, this exponential is highly suppressed. So the contribution comes from P near K. And this basically shows that we can evaluate this approximately, okay, and which will become better and better as sigma goes to zero, by simply expanding EP in a Taylor series expansion. So we'll expand EP in a Taylor series expansion around K, okay, both EP and as well as this P, and then carry out the integral over dQ. So to do that, let's define this momentum Q, which is the difference between P and K, okay, and change variable of integration from P to Q, okay, because you are going to do Taylor series expansion in Q. So you can then rewrite this integral, okay, instead of dQp, I write as dQq. Here, e to the ip dot r, instead of p, I substitute q plus k. Okay, so e to the iq plus k dot r. And here, you have e to the minus I, instead of ep, I have e of q plus k. And now I'm going to Taylor series expand. So the leading term is, of course, ek. Then there is a term that is linear in q, which I'm calling vk dot q. Okay, so that's what we have here. Okay. There are, of course, higher order terms which I've ignored. Okay, so there will be, for example, a term of order q squared times some coefficient, and so on. Okay. But those will all be suppressed in the limit of sigma goes to zero. Okay. And here you have e to the minus q squared by 2 sigma, right? Because p minus k is q. So what is vk? This is the first derivative of vk with respect to ki. Okay. And using the fact that ek is equal to square root of k square plus m square, it's ki over ek. Okay. So this in fact has the interpretation of the velocity of a particle carrying momentum k. Okay. In fact, in general, del ek del ki always gives the velocity of the particle of the corresponding momentum. Okay. Whatever relation you have for ek, okay, this is the velocity. Okay. So for example, if ek is p square by 2m, in the non-relativistic case, you will get ki over m. Right, that's exactly what the velocity is supposed to be. So is this clear so far? Any question? Okay. So let's do this integral. Okay, so we'll rearrange this a little bit. So the q independent part I have separated out. Okay, e to the I k dot r from here and e to the minus I e k t from there. Then the sigma to the minus 3 by 4, and then in the exponent I have combined all the q dependent parts. So minus q square by 2 sigma from here, then I q dot r from here, and then I q dot vkt that is from here. And now I can do the q integral by completing the square, and then you subtract off this r minus vkt whole square by 2, because when you complete the square there is an additional term of r minus. You know what has happened here. Okay, this should have been I sigma dot, no, what is, yeah, I sigma r and I sigma, this should have been at vk times t. I'm sorry, this is not k vector, because this is iq vk times t, right? So instead of this k, this should have been vk times t. So there's an r minus vkt whole square extra, okay, when you expand this out, because you only get these terms but you also get an extra term, which is the square of this. And that square of this is what I've subtracted out. Anyway, so then you can do the Q integral. Okay, this is Gaussian integral. Okay, you just shift the Q integral and then do it. And this is the final result. So this is, of course, phase, right? So what you see in the final result is that as far as the magnitude of the wave function is concerned, it gives a Gaussian that is peaked around r equal to vkt. And this is exactly what we had expected, right? Because the classical trajectory of this particle is r equal to vkt, right? This is vk is the relativistic velocity formula, right? This ki over ek or ki over square root of k square plus m square, this is a relativistic formula for the velocity in terms of momentum. And what you are saying is that we have a Gaussian here that is peaked around that trajectory r equal to vkt. Okay, and this is exactly what we had said here, that what generalizes the classical result, right? Because in the classical case, what I had said, in the non-relativistic case, or not classical, in the non-relativistic case, the peak moves according to the classical equations of motion. And what we see is indeed that that is also true for the relativistic case, the peak moves according to the classical equation of motion. The feature that you don't see is the fact that the width changes. And that's also true, in fact, here. And the reason that you haven't seen this is because you have not kept enough terms. So if you had expanded this out and kept the order q square term, for example, then the order q square term would have to be combined with this. And that will actually show that the width in the position space actually increases as a function of time. Okay, so I'll leave it as an exercise for you to do this expansion to one higher order, and then verify that the width also increases as square root of t, just as in the classical case. Just as in the non-relativistic case, not the classical case, as in the non-relativistic case. Okay, are there questions so far? Everything is clear? Okay, so let me proceed. So now we are going to discuss multi-particle case. Okay, what happens for multiple particles? So for the multi-particle case, we define this state p1 to pn, again as the product of AP daggers. Okay, earlier you had AP1 dagger to up to APN dagger on vacuum. So this represents a multi-particle state with particles carrying momentum p1 to pn. The only extra ingredient here is that I have used this normalization factor of square root of 2 EPI because of the fact that you have chosen to normalize the single particle eigenstates with this 2 EPI factor. Okay, that's for Lorentz invariance. And we'll define this state F1 to FN by simple generalization of the single particle case. So it will be given in the position space, it's given by this. So it's multiple phis, okay, weighted by these Fi factors, okay, acting on the vacuum. In the momentum space, it's multiple F tilde i's with this factor, weighted by this particular multi-particle state, p1 to pn. Okay, so take the state p1 to pn, multiply by the product of these Gaussians in the momentum space, and then integrate. And again, these are chosen as Gaussians, except that for different particles, we choose the peak of the wave function to be a different momentum. So ith particle momentum by ith particle wave function is peaked around pi equal to ki. And I'll be choosing these to be different, distinct. Okay, so I'll assume that ki and kg are distinct in general. And it's Fourier transform. Okay, this is just the same analysis that we did earlier. Okay, except that we do it for every I. Okay. So the Fourier transform F tilde I, Pi, F tilde I, Pi, I'm calling Fi of Ri, and that's given here. Now, note that I have chosen this width to be the same for all particles, but this is not necessary. Okay, I could have chosen different sigmas, you replace sigma by sigma I, So the width is different for different particles. But eventually we'll take all the sigmas to be small. So here we see that from this picture, we see that all the wave functions, Fi, Ri, peaks around Ri equal to 0. Okay, so they are all overlapping around Ri equal to 0. Okay, so this is a multi-particle state. Okay? But in the position space, the interpretation is that each of the wave functions are peaking around R equal to 0. Are there questions up to this point?
Are they not identical particles? So for bosons and fermions, shouldn't we take anti-symmetric and symmetric?
See, that is automatically encoded in the definition, right? Because for fermions, the API daggers will anti-commute. For the bosons, they commute. So the symmetry of the wave function, because in the second quantized language, symmetry of the wave function is always built in. You don't have to separately do anything about it. Is this
okay? Right? Yeah.
You're not saying that the first particle has this wave function, second particle has this wave function, right? First particle can be any of those. But this is saying that one particle has wave function peaked around K1, another particle has wave function peaked around K2, and so on. Is this clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Any other question? Okay, so now what we are going to do is to again time evolve them, just to get a picture of what's happening. Okay, so let's suppose that we take this multi-particle state, and we ask, if we had been using Schrodinger picture, how would this state look? So let's time evolve them. Okay, so you solve the Schrodinger equation, del del t of this, or I del del t of this is equal to h on this. Now, since n particle state will remain n particle, we can again try to solve them, okay, by using an ansatz. Okay. But in this case, in fact, the solution is trivial. Okay, and I'll write the solution, and then you can easily check that this is the solution. Okay. So here is the result. Okay. That we basically have to replace f tilde I pi by f tilde I ppi, the same procedure that we did earlier, which is given by e to the minus I pi epi t times f tilde I pi. Okay. And the reason is that if you take, for example, if you evaluate by e to the I h t, then e to the I h t or e to the minus I h t will simply give e to the minus I times sum over epi times t, right? So that can be written as a product of e to the minus I epi t. Okay. So you take this product e to the minus I epi t's, and then attach them into different FIs. Okay. That's of course your choice, right? See, so what I'm saying is that here, okay, you can just imagine that each of these Fi tildes get multiplied by e to the minus I Pi t. Okay. But the invariant thing, of course, is the whole state is getting multiplied by e to the minus I times sum over Epi times t. Okay. Because the energy of this state is simply sum over Epi. Okay, but you have a choice of attaching each of these e to the minus I epi t to each of these fi pi. Is this clear? So effectively, the time evolution means that each of the fi f tilde is will be multiplied by e to the minus I epi t. So with this definition, this state t f1 to fn, the time evolved version of this f1 to fn, will now be given by integral d cube ri fi t ri times phi 0 ri. Okay, what is fi t ri? This is just the Fourier transform of f tilde I t pi. Okay. Because all we are saying is that just like in these relations, right, if we replace f tilde I pi by f tilde I t pi, okay, we have to replace on this side fi ri by fi of t ri. But fi of tri is the Fourier transform of f tilde I tpi, just like fi ri was a Fourier transform of f tilde I pi. So here is fi tri. Fourier transform F tilde TPI, which we had carried out earlier already, right? In the previous slide, it's exactly the same calculation. Okay, that we did here. So Fi Tri is given by this function over here. So now it's a Gaussian. Okay, peak term Ri equal to Vki T. Okay, and Vki is again Ki over Epi, Eki. Okay, the relativistic formula for the velocity of a particle carrying momentum Ki. But now you see that something nice has happened. Whereas we started from a state for which all the peaks, all the particle wave functions were peaked around Ri equal to zero. But now if you go to large T, okay, either large positive T or large negative T, we see that peaks are getting well separated, right? This Ri equal to Vki T, these trajectories are getting well separated. In fact, the separation increases linearly as a function of time. So you have a well separated set of peaks. So in this form, okay, either at large positive time or large negative time, just by looking at the position space description of this state, we can see that it's describing a multi-particle state in position space. Okay, they are genuinely different particles in different positions in space-time. Okay, well, at fixed time, there are different particles in different positions. One particle at Vk1t, another particle at Vk2t, and so on. And now we see that because the width increases only as square root of mod t, whereas the separation increases as t, for large mod t, we can approximate the states as a set of well-separated particles. Okay, so you have to basically take t to be large enough so that the separation becomes larger than the width. And now we see that even if sigma was very small. So sigma was very small means that the width in the momentum space is very small, right? Particles are almost carrying momentum ki, almost always carrying momentum ki, okay, with a small fluctuation. So in position space, the width becomes very large, right? Because just from here, you can see the width is like 1 over root sigma in the position space. So for small sigma, the width is large. But even in that case, even though the width is large for small sigma, if we take T2 is sufficiently large, we can still distinguish different particles. Because the particle, the centers get separated far enough, so even large width wave functions are clearly distinguishable as separate particles. Is this clear? Are there questions?
Sir, how serious are we about taking the sigma going to zero limit?
Well, serious enough. Yes, we don't want to take it zero as yet, but we keep in mind that we can take it to zero. Okay, so whenever we need, we'll take it to zero.
Okay.
Right now we are not taking sigma to zero limit, but we'll get various insights by using sigma going to zero limit. Is that okay, or you want some more elaborate?
I think once we see the result, it will be more affirming.
Okay, yeah. So maybe once we see how we are going to make use of this, okay, the sigma goes to zero limit, it will become clearer. Okay, but that we'll see probably only near the end of today's lecture. Okay, any other question? Okay, so let me summarize what you have said. So what we have constructed here is a multi-particle state, okay, n particle state with a certain wave function. Okay, so it's not a n particle state, they are not exactly momentum eigenstates. Okay, there's a superposition of momentum eigenstates. Okay, so they have distribution in position as well as in momentum. At t equal to zero, all the particle wave functions were concentrated around r equal to zero. Okay, but what we are saying here is that at large time, okay, either large positive time or large negative time, these particles actually get separated in time, and their centers, the peaks, move along the classical trajectory. So physically, what this is saying is that this particular state, okay, if you think of this as Schrodinger state evolving in time, is describing a set of particles which are moving along certain trajectories. Okay. Then they are coming together at r equal to 0, at t equal to 0. Okay. And they are dispersing, okay, again as a set of particles carrying the same momentum along the same trajectories. Okay. And this, of course, is the reflection of the fact that it's a free field theory. Okay. That these particles really don't interact. Okay, and that's what is reflected in the fact that if we start, okay, that you can construct a state in which you have a set of initial states, okay, which are moving with a certain momentum, okay, along a common center, okay, and they come out, okay, with exactly the same momentum, okay, at late time. Okay, as if nothing has happened along the on the particle, except of course the width has changed a bit. Okay, but otherwise, nothing. The center hasn't moved at all, okay, from the original trajectory. So, are there questions? Okay, so let me now proceed. Okay. So next, you are going to turn to interacting theory. Now, as you have been doing in the interacting theory, we'll assume the existence of single particle states of mass mp. We had said that this assumption actually buys you something, because assuming this, we can actually work out what property the Green's function should have, and then we can actually go ahead and verify that those properties are true, namely the Green's function has poles. Okay, so let's assume the existence of single particle state of mass mp. Okay. So, and we'll denote by p the single particle state of mass mp, momentum p, and energy ep, which is given here. And we'll normalize it, okay, in the same way as before. So at the level of single particle, the only thing that will change, okay, is that m is replaced by mp. Otherwise, the analysis that we'll be doing will be more or less identical. So we'll again define the state f, okay, like this. Now, only difference is that you are not going to use this representation in terms of phi, okay, because that you don't know, right? This representation we don't know for interacting theory, okay, but certainly this one we know. Okay. So you define the state f with the f of p given by this, and f of p as usual will be interpreted as a momentum space wave function of the particle. Okay. So even though we are not going to make use of this representation, okay, we don't have this kind of representation, but we'll still continue to interpret the Fourier transform, okay, the analog of fi of ri or f of r, as position space wave function. Okay? Because that's just quantum mechanics, right? That the single particles should behave like, I mean, you should be able to use the usual notion of quantum mechanics. So if this should have been f tilde of p, okay? So if f tilde of p is the momentum space wave function, then its Fourier transform should give the position space wave function, right? That's that insight we are going to use even in the interacting theory. So here is the state again. And in the Schrodinger picture, if you evolve it, because this state has energy EP, okay, it's the same analysis. Okay, it evolves to a state like this, where F tilde TP is given by e to the minus IEP T times F tilde of P. Okay. Again, the only difference from the previous analysis is that EP is now given by this formula over here. Okay, square root of P square plus MP square. Is this clear? Are there questions? Okay, so this F tilde TP will interpret as the momentum space wave function at time t. And you will denote by F its Fourier transform. And this will have the interpretation as position space wave function at time t. Okay, this is what I had said, that we are going to use the standard insight from quantum mechanics, that if this is the momentum space wave function, then this should give a position space wave function. Okay. And of course, it's the same calculation that we did earlier. Okay. So FTR will be given by this, the Fourier transform of F tilde TP. Okay. Again, the only change is E. This is now the uses MP instead of M. Okay, so square root of K square plus MP square. And Vk also is the velocity formula for a particle, for a relativistic particle, but of mass m. So the classic, its peak time on the classical trajectory r equal to vkt. Are there questions? Okay, so now we are going to discuss multi-particle states. So let's think for a minute and ask, okay, what can we say from physical consideration, okay, even in an interacting quantum field theory. Now we have said that there exist single particle states. So if there exist single particle states, then common sense tells us, okay, and in fact the fact that we are dealing with local field theory tells us, okay, that there should also exist states in which there are two particles, okay, where one particle is at one position, okay, another particle is at a far away position, right? If there are two particles say 100 light years apart, okay, then they better exist, right? Because if single particle state exists, but then by doing an experiment somewhere here, okay, on the single particle, we are not going to know whether there is another particle 100 light years away, right? So there should be nothing which prevents us from creating a state which has two particles which are widely separated. Is this point clear? So what you are saying is that the existence of single particle also means that you should be able to create two particle states if the particles are widely separated. And this is true also for n particle states. As long as the particles are widely separated, we should be able to create such states. Furthermore, if there exists single particle states carrying certain momentum, okay, say a single particle wave packet carrying certain momentum, that whether you can have such a state or not shouldn't depend on whether you have another particle carrying some other momentum very far away. So you should be able to create states in which different particles move with different velocities as long as their wave functions are localized very, very far apart. So this is the insight that we are going to use. So this is the statement that I'm going to make now, that from physical consideration, it is clear that at any time t, there should be a state in which n particles are moving along widely separated trajectories, which will eventually intersect at some space-time point. So now we are talking about a more refined version, okay, that yes, indeed, their particles are very far apart. Okay. N particles are very far apart. They are moving along certain trajectory. Okay. But we'll choose those trajectories, okay, so that they intersect at some point in the future. Okay. They all come together, okay, at some space-time point in the future. Okay. There is nothing which can prevent me from creating such trajectories, okay, even if the particles are very far apart. Right? Maybe they are light years apart. Okay. Nevertheless, we can construct a set of trajectories which intersect somewhere in the future. So we'll assume that there exist such states. And for simplicity, we'll take the space-time point where they meet in the future to be at t equal to 0. So let me make this more precise. So what we are going to make a claim that there is a state which in the far past appears to have n particles moving along the trajectories ri equal to vkit with wave functions which are given here. So these are single particle wave functions. So what you are saying is that we should be able to create single particle wave functions which are Gaussian wave packets, and we should be able to create them independently of whether some other particle exists, so very far away. So it's my choice to create a wave function, and I am saying that it should be possible to create a state, okay, a multi-particle state, okay, with particle wave functions given by this, the same structure that we had earlier. I think somewhere, yeah, this is fine. This is, okay, so this is the position, momentum space wave function, and this is the corresponding position space wave function. Okay, time-dependent position space wave function. Okay, yes, go ahead, please.
Sir, is it necessary that the structure of the particle will be changed? if they are widely separated?
Well, I mean, we are assuming, since we are dealing with 5 to the 4 theory, right?
Okay.
With a single scalar field.
Okay.
The single particles are all the same single particles, right? Because the mass of the particle is fixed by the theory. So in that sense, it's the same single particle. The wave functions, of course, need not be the same, right? So the FIs need not be the same. And in fact, they are not, right? I have chosen the FIs to be peaked around different KIs, but with the same sigma, same width. But that's certainly not necessary. Right? You could have made it sigma
I.
Or you could have chosen some other functions. So wave functions indeed can be chosen completely independently. Okay. As long as they follow single particle, correct evolution of the single particle wave function, right? So you cannot, for example, change the T dependence. Because this is a single particle, this is how the single particle wave function evolves, right? So by doing an experiment somewhere, right, we should get exactly the same result, okay, whether the other particle existed or not. Okay, so the time dependence is fixed, right? But otherwise, of course, there is nothing which prevents you from choosing the space dependent, the time independent part of the wave function arbitrarily. Okay, corresponding time dependence will change.
Okay, sir.
Are there other questions? Okay. So this is what I have said again here, that if we do any local experiment around Ri equal to VKIT, the state will be indistinguishable from the single particle state. Okay. We wouldn't know whether some other particle exists very far away. Okay, so this is a single particle state which we'll see, okay, for that around this trajectory. Okay, so now, so this state that we have, okay, which is the collection of single particle states like this. Okay, this is at time t in Schrodinger picture. Okay, what is it at time t equal to zero? Okay, so it is some state at time t equal to zero. Okay, and whatever that state is, that should have this kind of structure, because if these are the wave functions of the single particles, just by the linearity of quantum mechanics, right, the superposition principle, okay, that must be some state, okay, which are denoted by p on to pn in, okay, such that this particular linear combination, okay, describes the state that we are describing, that we denoted here at time t. Is this point clear? See, each particle has a wave function f tilde I tp. So the combined wave function is f tilde I tp, product of I f tilde I tp. So this state, so there must be some state, okay, which you don't know what it is. But there is some state which I'm going to call p on to pn in, such that this part, this combination describes this intuitively, the intuition we have about this state which must exist. Okay. That at time t, when t is large and negative, okay, there must be a state of this kind, okay, where individual particles have this wave function. Okay. And we are saying that let's define this p on to pn in as some state such that this particular linear combination describes the state that we are after. Are there questions?
Okay. This p1 to pn in need not be a product state, right?
No, it's not. In general, it is not. And I'm not assuming that it's a product state.
Okay.
But this has to be a product because this is a far away, it was the wave function of the product of f tilde i's, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So just by linearity of quantum mechanics, right? It will be that wave function multiplying something, right? That something need not be a product state.
Can you say it again?
Yeah. So what I'm saying is that initially that the wave function of the of this multiparticle state, okay, was product over I f tilde I tpi. Okay, yeah. If you denote by p on to pn the momentum of these particles. And now what I'm saying is that there should be some basis of states, right, in which we can write the state in this fashion, this linear combination. Okay. then integral dq pi over 2 epi times f tilde i tpi times p on to pn in. This state need not be a product state. Okay, there is in general no description in which this is a product state.
Yeah, okay.
Okay. Are there questions, comments? Is this clear? Okay. So in other words, this is the state which when evolved backwards, okay, but with these weights, okay, when evolved backwards, okay, describes a multi-particle state where the particles are all moving along some classical trajectories, okay, towards a common center. Okay, if there is confusion, please ask, because we are going to repeat the same thing again next time, in the next slide for the far future.
So this is not a product state in the sense that this is not an eigenstate of the Hamiltonian we are working with?
No, it will be an eigenstate. It's just, it's not writable as a product of, you know, some creation operator, say A Descartes PI on the vacuum.
I mean, we are labeling the state with some P1 to PN. So are we going to assign the interpretation that when the particles meet, they have definite momenta?
No. Only at large negative time, they have definite momentum.
So here it's just for the purpose of labels.
Yes, just for the purpose of labels.
H acting on this will not, I mean, at least the momentum operator acting on this will not give sigma pi.
We'll see. It will give sigma pi.
I mean, okay, that is, but because it is conserved, but.
Yeah, but it will not have the interpretation that it's given by the pi's of individual particles.
Yeah, okay. Yeah.
Okay, but far away, if we evolve it at time for large negative time, okay, this will have the interpretation of individual momentum being ki.
Yeah,
because it's a peak turn on pi equal to ki. Yes, quiet please.
I was asking that in identical particles quantum mechanics, if the particles are far off, we can take them, the position space wave function, we can take them to be product states, but it might not be true for momentum space wave function. So here as well, that is happening, that their positions are far apart at time t tends to minus infinity. So can we take the momentum space wave functions to be product as well?
Okay, so they are never product in that sense, right? Because there is always a symmetrization, okay, and that's built in here. Because this state is automatically symmetrized under the exchange of the PIs, right? Whether you call it P1 to PN or P2 P1 up to PN, it's the same state. So maybe I should have said that. So this state, the fact that it's symmetric is automatically built in here. That you will not distinguish between P1 P2 and P2 P1, right? You will declare them to be identical states. So that symmetrization is automatically built in, right? Whether you work in position space or momentum space.
Yes. So what do we mean by here that they were product states?
Okay. What you meant by in the P theory, right? This was a product of A Descartes PIs acting on the vacuum. Okay. In that sense, we are calling it a product state, right? You don't have to call it product state. Okay, because the symmetrization is automatically built in.
Okay.
But it was product only in the sense that it's a product of A Descartes PI is acting on the vacuum. Is this point clear?
Yes.
Okay. Any other question?
Sir, I don't understand the last line, like the state described above for large negative time.
That this is the sort. So what you are saying is that this is the this state, okay, by definition at large negative time corresponds to these states that we are describing here, right? So these are the qualitative description of the state, right? We see that there must exist some state which looks like n different particles, n particles in n widely separated along n widely separated trajectories, given by the momentum space wave function which is here, right? And the position space wave function which is here. We didn't say what this state, how to represent this state in the quantum field theory. Now we are making a more precise statement that in quantum field theory there is a state p on to pn, labeled by p on to pn, such that this particular linear combination describes this state that you are trying to describe qualitatively here. Is this point clear?
Sir, large negative time means we are talking about backward.
Yeah, large negative time because this interpretation, right? These particles are all coming close at t equal to 0, right? So at t equal to 0, you cannot interpret them as separate particles having separate wave functions. So this fact that they are moving along this trajectory is ri equal to vki t. This interpretation is valid only for large negative time.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Because these particles are, we said that they take widely separated particles, they should move, that there must exist a state where the particles start moving towards each other. That description is valid at large negative time, right? We don't know what happens to that state at t equal to 0. So in this sense, that at large negative time, this particular state will have this interpretation, okay? That they are individual particles moving along individual trajectories.
Okay, sir.
Any other question? Okay. Now I'm going to repeat this for future trajectories. Just like we say that you should be able to create a state, okay, in which different particles are widely separated and they are moving towards a common center. It should also be possible to create a state in which there are particles, again we are moving along widely different trajectories, but they are not moving towards a common center, they are coming from a common center. Okay, the particles are just diverging away from a common center. So this slide will look more or less identical to what we had in the earlier slide, except that now we are talking about trajectories which intersect at some space-time point in the past. And again, we'll take this space-time point to be at the origin. Okay, at t equal to 0, r equal to 0 is when all the trajectories meet. So then we say that there must be a state which in the far future appears to have n particles moving along these trajectories with these wave functions. And this means that if we do any local experiment around ri equal to vkit, the state will be indistinguishable from the single particle states. And now we postulate that there is another set of basis states at t equal to 0, which I'll call p on to pn out. Okay, this one I had called p on to pn in, if you noticed. So we'll say there is another set of basis states, p on to pn out, such that this particular state, okay, see this has exactly the same structure, okay, except that this has the correct interpretation as particle as widely separated trajectories for large positive time in the far future. Because this state that you are describing is a state that is has widely separated trajectories in the far future. These trajectories had been close together in the past at some point, that is at t equal to 0, r equal to 0. Is this clear? Are there questions? Okay, so here I have summarized the postulates again. So the first postulate is that at t equal to 0, there is a basis of states labeled by p on to pn in, such that this state describes n widely separated particles moving along the trajectories ri equal to vkit with momentum space wave function given by f tilde I tpi for large negative time. Okay, you can also write in terms of position space wave function, which are Gaussians along these trajectories. The second postulate is that at t equal to zero, there is another basis of states, which are called p on to p and out, such that the same kind of combination now describes n widely separated particles moving along the trajectories ri equal to phi ki t with momentum space wave function given by this for large positive time. Okay, so this is describes, this has the correct interpretation as widely separated trajectories at large negative time. This has the correct interpretation as widely separated trajectories at large positive time. Now, if it so happens that these states are identical, then this will mean that the same state, okay, so you look at the difference between these two states, right? The only difference is that here you have in, here you have out. If these were the same, then it will say that the same state looks like widely separated trajectories in the far past and the same widely separated trajectories in the far future. So that's what happened in the free field theory, right? Particles come in and they go out with the same momentum along the same trajectories, okay, as if nothing has happened. So if this is the case, then the incoming particles in the far past along these trajectories will evolve to outgoing particles in the far future along the trajectories, okay, the same momentum space wave function. Okay, except that this is for large negative time, this is for large positive time. And this is exactly what you saw in free Klein-Gordon theory. Okay. But in general, this is something that you do not expect in an interacting theory like phi to the fourth theory. Okay. And whatever you have said so far, okay, it doesn't follow that these two are should be equal. Okay. Because there should be one set of trajectories which are coming in. Okay, that we can create. We should be, physical consideration tells us that we should be able to create such a state, okay, where particles are moving in. Physical consideration also tells us that we should be able to create such a state where the particles are moving out. Okay. But nothing in the theory tells us that these should be the same states. Okay, that if the particles are moving in, okay, when they meet, okay, they should do something non-trivial. And in general, it will not the wave function will not evolve, okay, as if there are particles moving out, okay, without any change in momentum or wave function. So this then leads to the definition of the S matrix. S matrix by definition is the overlap between these out states and the in states. And this is what you have to try to compute. Are there questions? So this S matrix then should reflect the probability amplitude for scattering of a set of incoming states of momentum p on to pn to a set of outgoing particles of momentum q1 to qn, qm. I should have said particles, incoming single particle states. So there are two questions you have to ask. How do you calculate this? Okay, and this is what you'll learn in tomorrow's lecture, and perhaps it will take also the next week's first lecture, part of the first lecture. So how do you calculate this, okay, in an interacting quantum field theory? Okay. And the second part of the question will be how to relate this to experimental measurement, okay, where you actually do some experiment and observe something. Okay. This has, of course, different answers in different applications. Like in particle physics, you do one kind of experiment. In condensed matter physics, you do another kind of experiment. In cosmology, you do even yet another kind of experiment, and so on. Okay. But all of these can be makes use of this S matrix. Okay, the same S matrix can be related to different kinds of experiments in different applications. Okay. So we'll be focusing, so in this part, we'll be focusing mostly on particle physics viewpoint. Okay, and this I think we'll discuss only next week. So maybe I'll just say one final thing, okay, and then I'll stop. Okay, and here it will become clear the significance of the sigma goes to zero limit. Okay, and that's to look at the energy and momentum eigenvalues of these states. So because energy and momentum are conserved, right, we can calculate these energy and momentum eigenvalues by evolving them either backward or forward in time. So if we take this state, and evolve them backward using Schrodinger equation to large negative time. This would describe n widely separated particles moving along the trajectories ri equal to vkit and momentum space wave function given by this. And now let's take sigma goes to zero. We have to take sigma goes to zero, but not so small, so the width becomes larger than the separation, right? We have to first take t goes to infinity limit, or t goes to minus infinity limit, so the separation becomes very large. Then we can take the sigma goes to zero limit, so that each of these f tilde i's becomes sharply localized around pi equal to ki. And in that case, it's clear that the state should have momentum sum over ki, energy sum over eki. Is this point clear? Are there questions? That if we take sigma goes to zero, then the wave functions are sharply localized are in the momentum space. So this is also sharply localized around pi equal to ki. So this basically becomes proportional to k1 to kn. And so what it is saying is that the state k1 to kn has a definite momentum, which is given here, and a definite energy, which is given here. And this is what you have written here, that the momentum vector acting on k1 to kn should have this as a momentum eigenvalue, and the Hamiltonian acting on this should have this as the energy eigenvalue. And of course, the same result can be proved for out states by evolving the forward in time. So this is where we see that we can sometimes make use of the sigma goes to zero limit, although we don't have to take sigma goes to zero from the beginning, right? But when you need, we take sigma goes to zero. But we should take sigma goes to zero always after you have taken t goes to infinity or minus infinity for getting the correct interpretation. Okay, so I think I'll stop here. Maybe I just say this, that for single particles, of course, there is no difference between in and out state. Okay, single particle always remains single particle. And the vacuum also, there is no difference between in and out states. Okay, so for these two kinds, class of states, we can just drop the subscript. Okay, so I think I'll stop here. So are there questions?
So, yes, why are we exactly using Schrodinger equation to evolve these states?
Schrodinger equation to evolve this state. So when I said this, for example,
yeah,
we say that this should evolve like a single particle wave function, right?
Yeah.
And single particle wave function, we got this from solving Schrodinger equation, right? Where did that go? Here. See this, if, right? I used the Schrodinger equation to determine the time dependence. E to the minus iept came from solving the Schrodinger equation.
Yeah, but shouldn't we be using the equation of the particle? Like Klein-Gordon equation?
No, not Klein-Gordon equation. Klein-Gordon equation, the equation for the field, right?
I mean, that is also the equation of the single particle.
But Schrodinger equation, see, we are not changing the rules of quantum mechanics, right? Once you have gotten the H, right? See, these are now state, I mean, I have represented them as states in the field theory, right?
Yeah.
Right? So it doesn't matter whether they are Klein-Gordon or, I mean, whether these, which field theory it came from, right? Once you have written them as states in the field, see, Heisenberg equations we didn't change, right? We wrote e to the minus ih, e to the iht phi e to the minus iht as a time evolution.
For the operators.
For the operators, right? So now to go from the Heisenberg to Schrodinger, right? You just do a unitary transformation by e to the iht, right?
Yeah.
So the states evolve by e to the minus iht on the state. Right? Which leads to the usual Schrodinger equation. I del del t of the state is h times the state.
Yeah.
Right. So that part we have not changed.
That is fine.
Okay. So we are doing quantum field theory, right? But think of quantum field theory as first a classical field theory, right? So this box operator that we had is a classical field theory operator. You think of this as normal classical mechanics with many degrees of freedom, with some equations of motion. And then you quantize it by the standard procedure of quantum mechanics. Okay, you find the Hamiltonian for the field theory and then quantize it by the standard procedure of quantum mechanics.
So then in this field theoretic picture, the equations, the Euler-Lagrange equations that we'll obtain whenever we write a field, like in this case, the Klein-Gordon equation, or when we have the phi to the fourth theory, the equation will get modified. That equation has no relevance as such?
No, that equation has relevance in the sense that if you calculate h commutator phi, right? If you write phi dot equal to h commutator phi, what you get is what you would get from the classical equations of motion for phi, for that Euler-Lagrange equation.
So that is also how the particles evolve, right?
Yes, that's not the particles,
the fields.
Yes. But the state in the theory, see, there is a, okay. So quantum mechanics has two parts. One is the dynamics that in uses the Lagrangian, Hamiltonian and everything else, right?
Yeah.
And then there is a formulation of quantum mechanics, which tells you how the wave function evolves. I del del t of the wave function is equal to h times the wave function. That never changes. That doesn't depend on what the dynamics of the system is, right?
Yeah.
So it's the same for quantum field theories, right? The different quantum field theories, right? Whether you use lambda phi to the 4 or lambda phi cube or lambda phi to the 6 or do some other things, those are all contained in the expression for the Hamiltonian. But once you have got the Hamiltonian, then the rules of quantum mechanics is the same.
Yeah, and as long as we can also write this, these simple operators, a dagger as some h comma a commutator as iota del, I mean the usual operator, Heisenberg picture operator equation.
Yes.
And we can also write fields as some linear a plus a dagger by 2 or something like that. This all works out, but when we have some complicated field, we might not be able to do this.
No, we can always do this, right? It's just that it will not be linear anymore, right? In general, the equations will not be linear. But that's okay. Right? You are not assuming anywhere that the equations are linear, right? H may be very complicated here, right? You have not assumed anywhere that H has a simple form, right? In fact, the form of H has never appeared in this.
Yeah.
We got by without knowing the form of H so far, right? Because we have the single particle states. This is we had said single particle states has this energy momentum relation, and MP of course depends on what the theory is. So because you already know the energy eigenvalues for this simple class of states, right, we could avoid the use of H, right? Because you already know the eigenvalue.
Right,
that's how you could write down the solution, right? If you didn't know the eigenvalue, then of course you have to put actual that complicated H and solve this. Right, and for multi-particle states also, because we chose this particular class of states, right, which have this interpretation, then in the far past, they become widely separated single particle states. Okay. Again, we didn't need to know the explicit form of H, right, which may be very complicated. Okay. But we could simply use the fact that it is the sum of the energies of individual particles.
Yeah, so for all we know, we could be working with non-Klein-Gordon particles like electrons right now.
Yes, certainly. We could be. I mean, whatever I have done so far, right, except for some indices, right, the Dirac field will have some indices and so on.
Yeah.
This formalism will be true for all field theories. And in fact, I'm going through this in detail for Klein-Gordon, but I'll just write down the final answer for the other field theories that we have. Right? Because the analysis will be more or less the same, right, except for some indices thrown in, right, the analysis will be the same.
Yeah.
Is this point clear?
Sir, can you please repeat again, what do you say about Hamiltonian's role in the dynamics right now?
Okay, Hamiltonian's role in the dynamics, the reason that we didn't have to use the explicit form of the Hamiltonian so far is because you already know the eigenvalues, right? Because for single particle states, right, the information about the Hamiltonian has gone into the MP, right? Because for single particle states, we know that the energy momentum relation is this. So MP, of course, if you want to calculate MP in terms of the parameters of the theory, we need the Hamiltonian. Right? But because you already know the eigenvalues of this simple class of states, right? We didn't need to know the explicit form of the Hamiltonian. Right? The Hamiltonian may be a complicated Hamiltonian in terms of Klein-Gordon fields, right? It has a complicated structure, including the phi to the fourth term. But you haven't needed to use it so far. Right? And similarly for multiparticle states, the reason that we didn't need the Hamiltonian is because this particular multiparticle states, right, by construction, has this interpretation in the far past, they look like widely separated single particle states. So again, the energy eigenvalues are known, right? You just take the energy eigenvalue of each particle and add them up. Right? That's the reason why you didn't need to use the explicit Hamiltonian so far. But of course, when you actually want to calculate the S matrix, right? That's where the Hamiltonian information will come in. See, so far, all I have said, right? These could have been even equal, right? We don't know if they're the same or not. And the role of the Hamiltonian will be in determining this relation between in and out states, or more precisely, in calculating this S matrix. If the Hamiltonian is that of a free Klein-Gordon Hamiltonian, then you will see that this is trivial, that they'll give a bunch of delta functions. On the other hand, if it's the Hamiltonian of the phi to the fourth theory, then we'll see that this will be non-trivial. But so far, we didn't need to use it because we know the eigenvalues on these states. Is this point clear? Are there still questions? Any other question?
Hello?
Yes, go ahead, please.
Yeah, in general, I was thinking that we had to create a single particle state as we have described in, interacting theory. We would have to use some, it may be complicated, but we would have to use some function of I and pi and act it on the vacuum, right?
Yes, that's true.
So, like, what would go wrong if we had used like, and this function would depend obviously on the momentum that of the particle.
Yes.
And like, but what would happen? What would go wrong if we had like two of these operators and we would act that on the vacuum? I mean, they might not commute. So, particle creation operators commute in free field theory.
Yes.
They might not commute here, but other than that, is there any other problem?
If you apply two, no, there's no problem, right? But if you, the point is typically if you apply two of these operators, right? Or three of these operators, you'll still have a single particle component in general. The leading contribution will still come from the single particle intermediate state. Because we saw that in this, earlier case when we are discussing MP, right?
Yeah.
We saw that we can use phi, but we can use any other operator, right? In fact, that you can do even in the level of the Green's function, right? Here we worked with these Feynman diagrams, right? With phi's. Okay. But instead of phi, if we could have used other operators also, right? We could have used pi or gradient of phi or phi cube. Right. Phi square will not work because phi square has no mixing with single particle states because of this phi goes to minus phi symmetry.
Yeah.
So in general, if you use a generic operator, right, the leading contribution to the intermediate channel will still come from the single particle states. But it will also have contribution from multiparticle states. Right? It's not that there are no contributions from multiparticle states. Single particle states will give the poles, but multiparticle states will give other contributions. Right, so if you are saying if you use two phi's, for example, there'll be a contribution. Okay, in phi to the fourth theory, there'll be no contribution from single particle states if you use two phi's. But if you use three phi's, then there'll be contribution from single particle states also in the intermediate state. And that will be the dominant contribution.
Okay.
Right, and then there'll be other contributions. So even a single phi can create multiparticle states. Right, in phi cube theory, for example, if you use a phi and apply a phi, you can create three particles. in general. So this correspondence between one phi creating one particle and two phis creating two particles, this correspondence is no longer true in interacting theory.
I mean, this may not be true, but if there is a state that is a particle state.
Yes. But I think you got disconnected. Or
hello.
Go ahead, please.
Yeah, I'm saying if there is a if there is an interpretation of one particle state and even an interacting theory, there should be an operator that makes that one particle state.
Yes, true. There is.
That information not be any operators. There could be some complicated function of phi and pi.
Yes. I mean, see the point, typically any operator we apply will make that single particle state. Because this analysis...
No, I just want a single particle state, not a superposition of single and multiple particle states. I want only single particle state.
Okay, then you have to tune that operator very carefully, right? Which will have no overlap with multi-particle states.
Yeah.
And only will overlap with single particles. Yes, indeed, there will be such operators.
Yeah, and let's say we have constructed that operator.
Yes.
What would happen if we had applied two of these operators on the vacuum? Would it not be something like a two particle state?
Well, it may or may not be, right? We'll see that we'll try to construct approximately operators of that kind. Okay. But if you apply two of these operators, right, and if you create a two particle state, then you have to ask whether it is two particle state in the far future or far past. Because if you create a two particle state in the far past, which are moving towards each other, they will not remain in general two particle state in the far future. Right? So a two particle state is not necessarily an eigenstate of the Hamiltonian.
Yeah.
Right? Because it may evolve to a multi-particle state.
Yeah, I think he's talking about at some t equals zero only.
Yeah. So you should be able to create a two particle state at the far past.
I'm not talking about t equals zero only. I was thinking if we could create two particle states anyway.
Yeah, we could. In the far past, yes. I mean, when the particles are widely separated, yeah, right? Then we can create two particle states. But that they will not evolve into two particle state in the far future.
I mean, if there's a one single particle state and it since it is an eigenstate of the Hamiltonian,
yes,
the corresponding operator commutes with the Hamiltonian. And even if I had,
well, it has an eigen, not a common dot. It doesn't commute with the Hamiltonian. It commutes to some gives a multiple of.
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. And
okay, I understand.
Yeah. So in general, a two-particle state will not remain two-particle forever.
Yeah.
So what we'll do next time is to introduce creation, annihilation of part, the analogs of those. Okay. But those will create multi-particle states either in the far past or in the far future. It will not be the same operators which do this. And if you use these operators to create multi-particle states in the far past, okay, in general, they'll evolve into different kinds of states in the far future. You know, superposition of any particle states in the far future.
Yeah.
Okay. I think I'll probably have to stop here because the next class will start. So if there are other questions, please ask tomorrow. Okay. Tomorrow we'll start again at 1:30.